Hi, I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. This is a close look at Star Trek The Next Generation, Season 3, Episode 25, Transfigurations.
We are charting an unexplored star system within the Zeta Gellis cluster. This routine assignment is made for a refreshingly quiet time aboard the Enterprise.
I bet it won't be quiet for long. Worf and Geordi are hanging out in 10 forward. You may recognize that lady back there on the right. That's Christy Henshaw from earlier this season. Geordi took her out on a date in the holodeck, and she was totally not into him. Oh, here she comes.
Hi, Geordi.
Hi.
How are things down in engineering?
They've been fine.
Well, I'll see you around.
Yeah, Geordi is really bad at that. Everybody is heading to the transporter room. They have found a one-man craft crash on a planet and faint life signs. Oh, there he is. And he doesn't look so good. The doc needs a volunteer to hook up to the alien guy because he can't regulate his own heart rate. Okay. Geordi's, I got it. Looks like something jumped into his head and they beam out of there. Now we're in super sick bay and it looks like alien guy is missing an arm. Beverly is using a whole bunch of made-up words here. Inject some provolone, azine, something.
What about Commander LaForge? She's waiting in the diagnostic center. I need you to give him a full bio scan. See if there's any residual effect from that energy discharge during the Neuralink. Keep his arm in cryogenic stasis until the vital signs are strong enough for surgical procedures.
Turns out that one-man craft was actually an escape pod, so where's the mothership? Data says there's all kinds of debris around the planet. That's probably it. Worf says there's residual traces of phaser fire, and that thing Picard is holding is like the black box, I guess, from the escape pod. It's going to take Data a while to decode it. Michael Piller wanted to do a medical joke for some reason, so we're going to get a lot with the doc. Geordi says, can I please go now? And she says, yeah, your scans are clear. And he replies, well, I could have told you that. I feel great. Oh, there's Picard. How's your patient?
There was major trauma to his head and chest cavity, massive plasma loss, and severe damage to most of his organs.
What are his chances?
I believe he's going to live. I'm afraid I can't take the credit for it, though.
Beverly says, pretty good, but this alien guy seems to have regenerative powers, too. Hey, Picard, check this out.
Cell regeneration.
Yes. The thing is, it has nothing to do with the injuries. These are undamaged cells that seem to be mutating.
Do you have a theory as to the cause?
No. I've never seen anything like it in my life.
That's kind of weird. The guys are in 10 forward, and Data and Geordi are going on and on about that water bottle from the escape pod. And like the medical jargon, what they are saying makes no sense.
Perhaps we should examine your theory immediately.
Less talk. More synthahol. We came here to relax.
I am relaxed. In fact, I've never felt better.
Geordi is different. I guess that thing that went into his head gave him Riker powers because he goes and hits on Christy and they head off to the Arboretum.
I've been tutoring him.
I have removed patient John Doe from the emergency biosupport unit. Most of his major organ systems have regenerated themselves to the point where they can now function on their own.
Hey, alien guy wakes up. He doesn't have a name. They just call him John Doe. He's like, whoa, I'm not dead. That's cool, thanks. And who am I? I guess we have some amnesia going on. John Doe is healing super fast. The doc says he's 6 weeks ahead of schedule. Picard stops by. Alien guy still doesn't know his own name or what happened to him. I guess Geordi's lady problems are a thing of the past. There's probably going to be some kind of side effect, but there isn't.
I don't know what it is, but something sure has changed around here.
The only thing that's changed is you.
I'm the same old guy I always was.
If you say so. I don't remember the old Geordi having that much success with Miss Christy Henshaw.
There's Chief O'Brien, and he hurt his shoulder kayaking. This is the first time we see this, but it becomes a recurring thing all the way through Deep Space Nine. There's Ensign Wesley in his new uniform. Alien guy tells him that his mom is taking him on a tour of the ship tomorrow. Then O'Brien says, ah, come on, Doc, I'm dying out here.
Don't worry, my friend. You'll be all right.
The pain's gone.
It's completely healed.
Holy crap, alien guy is E.T. Beverly's like, what the heck was that? And alien guy says, I don't know, it's just instinct. Oh my, the crushes are having dinner. The only point to this is that Beverly has the hots for alien guy. Skip. Geordi and Data figure out that the water bottle thing stores information chemically instead of mechanically. Yeah, duh. So they map RNA or something and find a navigational chart.
Can you match these stars to our charts?
Computer, run transformational matrix calculations.
Information on this sector is incomplete. No correlation.
I'm not giving up yet, not after coming so close to cracking this thing.
They don't give up. Data somehow figures those icons are pulsars, and then somehow figures out their noted rotation, and then the computer says there happens to be a matching pulsar nearby. So they go that way. So, good news, alien guy. We think we can get you home. But he's like, no, I can't go back. I still have no memory, but I do know that me and the others were trying to escape. Picard tells him they won't get to the system for 3 weeks, so he has plenty of time to get his memory back. But earlier, the computer said it was 2.3 parsecs away, so they must be at low warp for some reason, because they did 23 parsecs and Tin Man in less time. Well, alien guy can really glow now. So those two are having screwdrivers and tend forward, and they're happy to be friends, and alien guy is on a journey that he must complete, and that's it, so skip.
Sir, I am reading a vessel on long-range scanners. It is coming from Sector 9569.
What configuration?
Impossible to identify at this distance. However, it is on an intercept course.
Data says there's a ship coming at them at warp 9.72. Holy crap, that's really fast. Worf tries to hail them, but they don't answer. Back to this guy already, and he's still glowing, and it's getting worse. Apparently he got his pants from the David Bowie Goblin King collection. He's like, oh, I must get off this ship, and he goes for a run. Hey, there's the Elbez. This is at least the third time we see that. And it looks like alien guy wants to take it for a ride.
Step away from the controls. I have no wish to harm you, but you must return to sickbay immediately.
I cannot control what is happening to me.
So Worf's stunt double should be dead. Oh, and he is. Of course, alien guy fixes him up right away, so it's not a problem. Picard asks alien guy why he tried to steal the shuttle, but he doesn't know. Picard says the only reason I haven't thrown you in the brig is because you rose Worf from the dead. Whatever is happening to alien guy is accelerating. Bev says his body is generating an electrical field. Wow, Doc, pretty sure we all do that.
Who are you? What are you?
I'm afraid. For myself.
For all of you. I have to get away.
Data chimes in and says the other vessel is now in weapons range with shields up. Sometimes the Enterprise's sensors aren't so helpful. They should have detected that a long time ago. There's the alien ship, and they actually answer the hail this time. John Doe tells Picard that the guy on the screen is dangerous.
I am Commander Sunad of Zalkon. You are trespassing into our space, and you are holding a Zalconian citizen.
We do not intend transgression of...
You will return him to us immediately.
Well, he seems pleasant. Turns out John Doe is one of four escaped prisoners, and they killed the other three already. So give him back so we can kill him too.
Of what is he accused?
He is a disruptive influence. He spreads lies.
In what way?
That is not your concern. I will give you 2 hours to comply.
So, they have 2 hours. Worf says their ship is comparable to the Enterprise, so fighting's not a good idea. Troy says these guys are no joke, and the hatred for John Doe here is super obvious.
But there's something else. Zalconians are afraid of John.
Commander Riker, Counselor, Doctor. John, I want you to join us. Mr. Data, you have the bridge. Mr. Worf, stay tactical. Counter any move the Zalconian makes.
Alien guy tells Picard he will surrender if necessary, but he feels that this whole thing is bigger than just him. Whatever it is needs to happen. Picard says, okay, I'll let you know what I'm going to do. Bye.
Captain, you can't seriously be considering...
We must consider all options, Doctor, and not let our personal feelings impede our judgment.
You're going to tell me it's irrelevant that we'll be sending him to his death.
Whether we approve of the Zalconian's intentions is not the issue.
Riker points out that if this situation were reversed, they'd want their citizen back. Troy's like, yeah, as far as they're concerned, we shouldn't even be involved. What to do? Picard's talking to, his name is Sunad. And Sunad is like, look, we don't want to be your friends, just return our criminal guy and go away. Picard says, yeah, okay, fine, but it would be nice if you could explain John Doe's crimes a little better. That's none of your business. Yeah.
There's something else. Since his recovery, he's manifested unusual abilities.
What kind of abilities?
He apparently has the power to heal injuries with a simple touch.
I guess these aliens are like Darth Vader, and they force choke Picard and everybody else. Not Data, of course. But they don't bring that up. John Doe fixes Beverly right away, but there are over 1,000 people on the ship.
It's come back to me, Beverly. I know who I am.
Oh,
Why was Data on the floor? He doesn't breathe. Anyway, everyone is fine now. Sunad is ready to blow up the Enterprise, but John Doe says, "No way, Sunad. The Force is strong with me." Wow, yeah, he's not kidding.
"Captain, my species is on the verge of a wondrous evolutionary change, a transmutation beyond our physical being. I am the first of my kind to approach this metamorphosis."
Okay, so John Doe is the next evolution of his species, but they've been oppressed by the status quo, yada yada. A new day has dawned. The Enterprise crew is kind and generous, unlike you jerks, and I'm going to turn into Cinder from Killer Instinct.
"There is nothing to fear. You can join me."
"Don't touch me."
"As you wish. Those who are willing will follow me."
So Sunad leaves and glowy John Doe says bye. "Thanks for your help. And Beverly, I guess we can't hook up now." This episode is kind of weird, and it all comes from the writing. This is Rene Echevarria's second TNG script, and he goes on to do a ton of stuff with Deep Space Nine, but this thing here is a bunch of weird stuff. Techno babble is kind of a staple of Trek, but the way it's used here didn't even try to make sense. The blue bottle thing was described as a feedback loop controller, and then the thing that augments flight controls, and what are they talking about? It's data storage. That's all they would have had to say. And what's up with Christy Henshaw? There was this whole scene earlier in the season that was very clear about the point that she's not into Geordi, and now all of a sudden she approaches him even before the thing went into his head? Okay. And speaking of that, it was never explained. And it's not like he becomes Pimp Daddy Geordi from here on out, so it was just for this episode. It's very weird. There's nothing bad about this. It's fine. I just think it's weird. I'll give it points for the message that you shouldn't oppress evolution, but that's not a thing humans have to deal with at this point, so I don't know who this was for. Maybe there are people out there that feel evolutionary superior and are oppressed because of it. I don't know. Middle of the road, I'm going to do 3 deltas out of 5. You can let me know how you feel about that. If you liked that video, thanks. Make a comment and subscribe if you want. If you didn't like it, I thought it was kind of weird too. There's more Star Trek videos and other related content on my website. Check it out at kellyplanet.com. I'm Eric Kelly. Live long and prosper.